Well, hello, everybody. This is Brother Grizzle. I try to get the music to work. I don't know what the deal is, but praise God that we're in the house of prayer. I got a guest in tonight.
Check it out over there at the Gospel Music Jukebox Room. And, man, we just seen God pouring out His Spirit there in the housing project. We have people coming over and out of there. And, man, it was just awesome to be a part of that.
Amen.
You know, me and the wife, we drove up. And, hey, I got to tell this on myself because I preach a lot about, you know, take nothing when you go. When you're sent to preach revival, I believe you take nothing. You know, you don't get to take your Winnebago's and your pillows and you know, really take nothing except the staff. You know, you don't take no money. You don't take no two coats, you know, and you really just go trusting and having your faith in God. I really believe that. Well, guess what? This wasn't my revival. I just come down to pray for them and be a part. I caught myself. I had to borrow my granddaughter's car. And guess what? I'm driving a Mercedes-Benz. And I got me a motel room. And I thought, Lord God, I can't do that. And then I said, yeah, I can. This ain't my revival. I'm just coming to support the brothers. And it's been like, I don't know how long. But it was just a funny experience for me to come and support my brothers in the Lord as they were holding this revival that God set. And there was my son, Chris Chaney, preaching in it. And that is a blessing. When doing the radio program, you ought to see what an electronic nightmare he's got going on. But God's giving that gift, and that's pretty awesome. But it's good to be live on the radio. Even on the road, God makes a way, and that's pretty awesome to me. Amen.
Amen.
Because God's just good, and there's just no other way to say it. Praise the Lord. All right, have we got a song about ready, Brother Willie?
And oh, yeah.
Amen. I'll turn it over to Brother Willie.
All right, here we go. That long, one last ride.
You hear me? We ain't hearing nothing.
Mm-hmm. Well, this ain't good.
You want me to sing solo?
Soprano, huh?
Solo, nobody could hear me. Praise God.
Praise God. Well, let's see. Just a second. Tell them what's going on.
All right. What's happening right now? Brother Willie's doing that high-tech redneck stuff. Amen. And so we're going to leave that up to him. I'm going to have you, if you got your Bibles, you want to check out in Ephesians chapter 6. But we're going to be talking about the preparation of the gospel of peace. Amen. You can remember as the brethren gathered around, you know, they were desperately trying to convince Paul to abandon his plans to travel to Jerusalem. You know, they had heard the prophecies about the fate that awaited him, you know, on that journey. Paul himself said that he did not know what to expect. Expect that the Holy Spirit testifies in every city, you know, saying that chains and tribulations await me. Look in Acts chapter 20, verse 23. Paul's brethren and fellow workers, hey, they couldn't bear the thought of their friend willingly walking into this. And, they begin to, they begged him to, reconsider this journey. How many of you have been there where you've had to go do something for God? and everybody around you is trying to talk to you, hey, man, really pray about this, you know, change your mind, you know. But the truth is, as we step out to share the gospel, then we do have enemies that rise up and try to stop us. But God, through the Holy Spirit, had just summoned Paul to Jerusalem. Look in Acts chapter 20, around verse 22 there, and you'll see Paul was intent on answering that call. Those of you that's called by God, you know that we must get up and go into the world. He said, go ye into the world. You can't do it by sitting on the couch of doubt, as Brother Willie shared many times, we've shared with you. You know, you can do it through the internet or you can do it through radio, but that's not all. You've still got to go, and you still got to get involved in the lives of the people that you're preaching the Word of God to. You've got to be hands-on. God's a hands-on God, ain't he? But anyway, but you know, the Lord had summoned Paul to Jerusalem. There in Acts 20, verse 22, you can see. And Paul went on answering that call. Now, knowing that the upcoming trip could very well mean the end of his life. Have you ever been there?
Oh, yeah.
Where you know, you just failed. Everybody was telling you. You know, I just got threatened the other day. Got brothers praying for me that, you know, they're worried about somebody coming to my house and shooting me. Well, I've been shot at. I've been stabbed. I've been beat. And I ain't went nowhere and ain't going nowhere till God says, come on home, son. But as your enemy rises up, I tell you what it will do for us, like Paul that's called, it'll cause us to draw closer to God, because that's where strength comes from. He is our shield. He's our protector. Amen. But also, while you're there, look in Acts 21, around verse 13. But, I mean, read the whole chapter now, for real. See, when you read the Word of God, allowing God to write His Word upon the tablet of your heart, my friend, and then you become a doer and you apply what you read from the Word of God, apply it to your life. You got to know this. If you don't apply the Word of God to your life, hey, it's none effect to you, man. I mean, you can read it. You know, the devil himself knows the Word of God.
That's
they
right.
Share scripture upon scripture upon scripture. But if they're not a doer, if they're not doing something for the kingdom of God, then the Word of God reads them out. They're hearers only. They're not doers. Hearers only ain't going to make heaven. Do you not understand?
That's,
I mean,
right.
It's that simple. It's, don't complify the Word of God. It's real simple. But, you know, he knowed very well that Paul knowed it could have meant the end of his life. He says to his would-be discouragers, what do you mean by wimping and whipping and breaking my heart? You know, see, when people try to discourage you from obeying God,
that's right,
it hurts your heart, because you thought they would be with you and help you and pray for you and say, go, brother, what can I do to help you get there?
Amen.
You know, not, don't you go, you're going to get killed out there. You could get hurt. You might, you'll go hungry. Nobody will help you out there. Well, there is people of God, and there is a move of God going on right now. We are at war with
That's
the
right.
devil and the legions of angels, and there are many being deceived. Listen,
right.
when you hear great anointed men of God saying, I'm the only one can help you, be careful, because, listen, God is the only one can help you, my friend. You understand? You got to have things settled and right between you and God, or nobody can help you.
That's right.
It's the blood plus nothing. It's Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior. Like Paul here, he knowed that God had summoned him to go to Jerusalem, so he was going, even if it cost him his life. You know? So, you know, he says, I'm ready not only to be bound, but also to die at Jerusalem for the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Look at Acts 21, verse 13, and you'll see what I'm telling you. The Word of God is the truth. So I asked you this morning, do you have things settled? Are you willing, even unto death, to obey God?
That's right.
If you are, and God puts a burn in your heart to go somewhere, to go reach out and help somebody, and you may have to go right amongst a drug-infested, alcohol-filled neighborhood, and they may come out and threaten to kill you, and they may kill you.
That's right.
God, that may be your day of going home, but man, to me, what an awesome way to die, you know, is to be, to the Lord allow you to meet death and to be with Him while you're preaching the gospel.
Amen.
Man, up doing something for God. I'm like Paul here. I'm going, you know, my saying is I'm going hell or high water. You know, I'm going, there ain't a devil in a pit of hell stop me. I'm going forth in the name of Jesus, and I'm going to go obey the Lord, what he's put in my heart, not your heart. I've got to do what I got to do, and you need to be doing whatever God's told you to do.
Amen.
And just be obedient to God. But anyhow, I wanted to really get you into the Word this morning. So now I know you're in the book of Acts. I know you're in the 20th chapter. You're looking for verse 23. Then I run you over to Acts chapter 21. Look at verse 13. And you'll understand what Paul's feeling here. You know, hey, look, I done got my life settled. I done got a made up mind. I'm going. The Lord summoned me to go to Jerusalem. I'm a going. Now, if you won't go with me, come on. If you don't, get out of my way.
Amen.
I'm a going. I'm a going to a lost world. Do you hear me? Old evangelist Brother Eddie Cheney saying, hey, friend or foe, listen to me. I'm a going. If you want to go with me, good. If you don't, then get out of my way, because I've done got a made up mind. Come hell or high water, death or life, I'm going to obey God. If this is my last day on earth, I want to be found doing something for the kingdom of heaven, for the kingdom of God. I want to be found telling somebody there's a way of escape and his name is Jesus Christ. I want to be found telling somebody there is hope if you're addicted to crack cocaine. There is hope if you have a lying spirit upon you. There is hope if you're living in a lifestyle of homosexuality and lesbianism. There is a hope. There is deliverance, and his name is Jesus Christ. Amen. Our precious Lord and Savior. And I've got a made up mind. I've been threatened at home. I get threatened on the internet a lot, you know, and I take those serious, because there is people that will drive to kill you if the Lord would allow it. But I know that nothing can happen to me, nothing can happen to you, unless the Lord allow it today. Do you hear me? Now, he woke you up today. What a wonderful, glorious day. It is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad. Look here, we're blessed to get another opportunity to tell someone there's a way to escape the pit of hell. There's a way to escape them eternal flames of fire where the worm dieth not.
That's right.
And he said, listen now, if you'll go to him with a broken heart and a contrite spirit, for real, if you're ready to be set free from the whatever addiction may be in your life, you can be. All you have to do is repent. Turn from your sins, run into the arms of Jesus, cast your cares upon him, because he cares for you, my friend. Do you hear me? It's that easy. It's that simple. Now, if you live, I guarantee you'll want to be water baptized. The Word of God's, if you live, you will be. You must be if you're going to obey the Word of God. You see, a lot of people, like the thief, they may die before they get to the water.
That's right.
But now, if you've
got that's your... That's something I've always wanted to ask you. Does it say in the Bible them old criminals up there was baptized? No.
Hey, man, good thought. Well, you know, the question arose the other day. A guy asked me, he said, well, before Jesus himself was water baptized, was he in the will of God or out of the will of God?
He was in the will of God.
He was in the will of God.
But what did he say? He says, trouble me.
Yeah.
Trouble me to show.
Yeah.
The will of the Father.
Amen.
It's, brothers and sisters, it's all right there.
It's there.
It's in the scripture. If you'll just seek out the will of the Father.
Amen. Get in there and read that word and allow God to write it upon the tablet of your heart.
But the biggest like problem with the church today, they bits and pieces.
Well, the truth is, in today's world, 99.9% of your forms of religion are false.
Yeah.
I mean, that's the truth. There's few that find the way. That's the truth, the narrow path. And listen, when you got to go to one of these denominations and you got to go by their mandates and their rules and they have their schedule and they do their man set things in this place, it no longer is the house that was donated to God. It becomes the house of Bob. Yeah. And that's the truth. I mean, now people get madder and hell is hot, but it ain't going to change the fact that the truth is, they gather people into these denominationalism buildings, and they pat each other on the back. They don't reach out. Now, the ones that's out there reaching out, that's feeding the hungry, clothing the naked, really getting involved, you know, they don't even want the expense of a building. They don't even want that. That's just becomes a burden.
It ties them down.
It does. Responsibility, keeping it up.
I mean, you got to keep up electricity bill, and you got to keep up insurance.
It's a lot easier to just load up in your car and go into the world and preach the gospel by being a doer of the word of God. And when necessary, use a few words.
Yeah, amen.
But you preach the gospel by applying the word of God by being a doer. That preaches a whole lot more than we can ever say.
It's just like I always tell everybody that seeing is believing.
Amen. Well, that's right.
I mean, if you'll hear people say, well, I'm going to go do this, I'm going to do that. So, well, don't tell me, show me.
Yeah. Amen. You've heard me say, Brother Willie, many times, I got that show me attitude. You say you got God? Well, let me see God in you, man. Yeah. Let me see you get out of the living room. Let me see you get out of the comfort
zone. And there's a reason. There's a reason why I tell you, show me, because what does it say about your rewards?
Yeah.
If you seek for your rewards on this earth, if you've already got them.
You already got them. Yeah, they ain't no
good.
But
if you want, you go to the end of your closet. The Lord said, what did he say? He said he would reward you openly. Now that's,
yeah, amen.
That's what we got to be doing. We don't need to be pat on the back. We need to be serving God on high and let him reward us. I'd rather have a spiritual reward than I would a physical reward.
Yeah, hey, man.
A plaque will burn on the day of judgment.
Yeah.
But the rewards in heaven will never be corrupted.
Amen.
And never be stolen by a thief or a robber.
Ain't that good news. Ain't that good news.
Amen.
Ain't that good news to know. I would rather keep my treasures up in heaven.
That's right.
You know, this old world's going to burn away one day.
That's right.
And these houses and all this man-made stuff you see is going to be gone. And I know we have a false religion out there. The Jehovah's Witnesses teach that, when you die, you get to come back and pick which house you're going to live in. And you get to pick through all these treasures here on earth. That's a lie from hell. Because you ain't coming back to pick no house. Why would I want to be in a house when Jesus built me a mansion?
That's right.
My name's inscribed above the door, and I get to be with my precious Lord and Savior for eternity. I ain't coming back to pick your house so you can keep it. You know, but...
just like they got a religion out now. I heard the other day that said, we're building our kingdom on earth. Well, if I ain't mistaken, doesn't Revelation John says he sent a new kingdom?
Coming down. Well, glory.
I mean, now, what...
Walking in Jerusalem just like John.
I mean, well, why would we want to build something that had to be maintained that no hand of man has ever touched?
Amen.
It's coming down. I mean...
I can't wait. I'm ready. Praise God. I got a longing to go home, brother.
Amen.
Praise God. I can't wait. I'm excited to get to be and spend eternity with my precious Lord and Savior.
That's right.
And I can't even begin to imagine what he's put in my mansion and what it looks like. Just imagining as he went away to prepare you and I a place if you've been born again, bathed in the blood.
Amen.
If you can hold on and endure to the end, those of you that are saved today, we got some suffering and trials to do. Like Paul here, he done heard the rumors. If you go, you know, it's kind of like I've been told, if you go to Mississippi, if you go to Alabama, if you go to Scottsville, Kentucky, we'll cut your head off like we did John the Baptist, or we'll come up there and shoot you. We'll tear your tent down. Well, I'm going. So I guess you better be saving up your gas money, because I'm coming with the gospel. Amen.
Praise
and I'm
going
to preach you the truth because I love you. You see, I don't want my worstest enemy in this world right now, my worstest one, I don't want them to miss heaven. I don't want my worstest enemy to miss heaven and make hell their home. I love you enough that I'm going to, you know what I do for my enemy since these last couple of battles in my life. God told me if I wanted more of him, and how many out there wants more of God?
Amen.
I want everything God has for me, brother. And he said, well, you must love your enemy. You pray
for
them.
It's hard.
It's hard. There's times you just want to smack your enemy. You want to lay holy hands on them.
Amen.
And say, look here, I'm going to choke the devil out of you. You love them that much that it gets you frustrated. But that's when we turn to God. And he says, stand still now. Give your problems to God. Give your enemy to God and watch. He says, stand still and watch the salvation of the Lord at work in your life today, my friend. Amen. So you pray for your enemy and do good to them which despitefully use you. Do you hear me? Pray for them. We know they think they're really cool. When somebody's trying to abuse you and use you, they think they're so sly that you're so stupid that you don't know what they're doing. We know what they're doing. But we must continue to pray for them and keep taking them to the Lord.
That's over and over.
And don't quit praying. Don't quit praying. He says, pray without ceasing. Do you hear me? Paul had a made up mind right here in Acts chapter 21, 22. You can see Paul's mind is made up. He had heard if he went to Jerusalem, they're going to kill him. He knew it could have been the end of his life, but he goes anyway. Yeah. Wow, Paul did not just write about the armor of God. He also wrote it. Wow, that's powerful. At this time in his life, he was able to call upon, those shoes of the preparation of the gospel of peace. You see, he felt protection and strength in the knowledge of what God's gospel meant for him and for the others he shared that good news with.
Amen.
His footing was sure. You see, we're talking about unshakable sure. And he was prepared to carry the gospel wherever. Do you hear me? Wherever God sent him. Are you prepared?
Are you prepared?
Are you ready to go wherever God sends you? And be assured, he did tell you to go into the world.
Amen, bro. I got a question for you. Did you suit up today when you was at that hotel?
Amen. You better believe I did at 6 o'clock this morning.
Amen.
I woke up and thought I was I thought I'd overslept, and I thought, oh no, Willie.
Oh, you ain't gonna happen. You know, I got up before the break of dawn. There says, well, my alarm's off. I'm gonna get my drink here, grab my stuff, and then said, we're gonna go find old brother Eddie and see if he's awake.
Amen.
You know what happened, brothers and sisters? I pulled up there and I called him on the phone. He says, good morning, good morning, good morning. He was awake. I said, well, what you doing? He was doing some uploadings and stuff, and praise the Lord that he was doing the will of the Father.
Amen.
But you know, how many people today put on that suit of armor?
Think about it.
This is Sunday morning.
A lot of people don't.
See, the church where I usually go, it'll be starting about 30 minutes or so. And you know, bad part about it, they won't show up to the very last minute.
Yeah, now, I understand.
Brothers and sisters, today, I'm going to ask you, there's someone out there today, that needs the suit of armor upon them.
Amen.
So,
get dressed.
We need to be getting dressed. I know this is the Bible studies, but I just had it on my heart.
Hey, that's it.
I just wanted to give everybody prayer lines. Mine for the House of Prayer is 1-270-681-8098. Call anytime you want, 24 hours, 7 days a week. Or you can call Brother Eddie's on the Gospel Music Jukebox. It's 1-931-229-0768.
Amen. And you're right. We need to get dressed every day of our life because every day is a new day, which means a new battle with the devil. Man. We are at war.
That's right.
Whether people believe it or not or like it, or even some people don't want to hear this, but it's the truth. We are at war with the devil and his legions of angels.
That's right.
And the devil is seeking whom he may devour, my friends. If you're born again, if you're claiming Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, the devil is after you.
Uh-huh.
Do you hear me? Now, if you're not claiming him, and you're not born again, and you're not saved, he's got you.
That's right.
So
why would he tear you down if he's already got you?
That's right. He's done and got them deceived, so they can believe their lies and the devil's lies, and they think they're right. The Bible says when you say you know something, you know nothing as you ought. Mm-hmm. And they begin to build a lie upon a lie, but guess what? Like a deck of cards you build a house out of, it will fall. It will fall. When the wind of God blows, he said he would make the truth known. There's not a secret thing done in this world. God said he'll bring it to the light. And, you just can't hide from God.
It's just like the way the word of the Lord says, don't build your house on sinking sand.
That's right. Build upon the rock.
Amen.
Of Jesus Christ. And when he's talking about the truth, he'll set you free. The blood of Christ. The truth. No matter if you've done something wrong and you're accused of it and you know you done it, Just tell the truth. It ain't the end of the world.
Oh, yeah.
Just tell the truth. I did it. You know, I've been accused of womanizing. I've been accused of smoking dope. I've been accused of stealing over the years.
And talking about that smoking dope. You got a blessing this morning, didn't you?
Amen. I sure did. I haven't got to hear from my dad since I was accused of smoking a joint on the Tent Revival in Rienzi, Mississippi.
Right.
And I didn't have his new cell phone number.
Yeah.
But I've been praying, and thank God. Brother Willie was sitting here, and we was talking about it and praying for one of our brothers that's accused me of doing this, smoking a joint. And all of a sudden, the phone rung, and it was my dad. And
thank
the first,
God,
amen. First words out of my mouth, I said, "Here, Dad, would you tell Willie, I said, I'm being accused that you passed a joint to me in Rienzi, Mississippi."
Amen.
My dad got upset for a minute.
Yeah, he had some chosen words, but he did clarify. He says he don't know what he's seen, but it wasn't what he said.
Yeah, thank
so
God.
So, brothers and sisters, let's keep this brother in prayer,
now also keep my dad, Corbett Cheney,
amen,
in prayer. Listen, my dad, before he got saved, but can I share his testimony
in
a little
ahead.
Minute? My dad, as a young man, he was a thief, a robber. They robbed banks, and he was in and out of jail, and they got down there in Florida, and they was running from the law and got in a shootout, and, there was a couple got killed. They was a couple men got killed. My dad went to the pen for 25 years of his life. He never raised me. I didn't know him. He called me when I was 16 from the jail on my 16th birthday.
Yeah.
And that's how I met my dad, was on a phone call from the prison. My mother, I thought Emmett Clark, my stepdad, was my dad. That's when they had to tell me that he wasn't my real dad, that my real dad was a no account. Drug head, young.
I bet that was a bombshell, wouldn't it?
Well, I didn't know. It was weird because I thought Emmett Clark was my dad. Man was good to me, fed me. You know, I called him dad.
Yeah.
So here I am at 16, told he's not your dad. And so they explained. Well, anyway, to make it all short, when I'm 21, something like that, 23, somewhere, Dwayne was just a baby. Guess who showed up at my driveway in Whitesburg, Kentucky?
Old Corbin.
It was my real dad. He got out of the pen 3 days. He was out 3 days, and he came and found me, and I was in my living room, and I'll never forget this. I didn't go to work that day because I just didn't want to go. I was being sorry. And my mother had come to visit, and she walked through the door in front of my real dad was outside. She said, "Your dad wants to see you outside." And I said, "Well, tell him it. Come on in. I ain't going out there." She said, "No, honey, your real dad's going outside." I said, "Good, because I'm going to kill that son of a." And that's the words I said. And he never bought me a candy bar. He'd never been, you know, I didn't know about the prison. You know, they hadn't, I mean, I know he's in jail, but I didn't know why.
Right.
And I didn't know for how long.
Yeah.
Well, anyway, I walk outside and he's standing there with him. It was him and his uncle, Kermit, and my uncle, Kermit, his brother. And I remember walking up to him and I said, son, how you been? I said, "Don't call me son." I said, Emmett Clark's my daddy. And I said, "I don't even know who you are." And he said, "Well, I come to see my grandchildren." I said, "You got no grandchildren here." I said, "Best thing you can do is leave and don't come back." And he didn't. He said, "Now, whether you like it or not," this is where I believe I got this from. He said, "Whether you like it or not, or whether you believe it or not," he said, "I'm your daddy." And he said, "I'm going to be in your life."
Mm-hmm.
And I could see he was getting highly upset at this point, and I kind of stood there and looked at him a few minutes, and I said, "All right, I shook hands, and I said, we'll start it off, and we'll see where it goes."
Amen.
And about five, he leaves that day, he met my wife, he met his grandbaby, and he leaves that day. I got saved, I was back in church, me and Pauline living right, boy, trying to do good. About 5 years goes by. He shows up at a tent revival. I hadn't seen him for 5 years now. He left my driveway.
Yeah.
Okay, he shows up. He was drunk. He had a case of beer in the back seat. And, man, here I am nervous, thinking he's going to rob the tent revival and knock the preacher in the head or something, you know. So I go over to the pastor, and I tell him, I say, "Look, my dad just pulled up, and he's a mean dude, man." I said, "He ain't got no sense. He's drunk. I'm going to try to get him going down the road." Preacher said, "You leave him alone." So him and people like him is why we're out here in revival.
Amen.
And I thought, yeah, but this my dad. Listen, this man, I mean, I thought there was no hope for my dad. I've been told all these stories. I thought he was unsavable. I really did. As a young man, I really and plus I had anger in my heart.
Yeah.
You know, I was hurt. He didn't raise me. I felt he didn't love me. But anyway,
you know, that's sometimes anger is the hardest thing to overcome. There's two sins that a lot of people don't want to overcome. It's anger and pride.
Amen. Pride's a toughie, ain't he? But anyway, my dad gets out and he comes down and he says, "What y'all doing to the preacher?" He says, "Well, we're getting ready to have a water baptism." Now, my dad is a video camera nut. He loves taking pictures. Guess what? My dad says, "Well, do you care if I video it?" Now, this is a drunk man.
Yeah.
That old preacher said, "Why, no?" Well, dad didn't just stand on the bank. He said, "I believe." Now, they put anointing on that in that river. This is a river. They anointed it and prayed over it. Guess what? He said, old Corbett said, my dad says, "I believe I can get a better picture if I go out there." The old preacher smiled and said, "Yeah, you can."
And
so here he goes with this video camera on his arm, them old biggins back then, you know. He goes out in that water, man, and he's videoing them, bringing the people into the water and everything, you know. And he comes out of the water and the baptism's over. And my dad says, "Where y'all going from here? You know, where y'all going from here?" And,
You forgot the Lee Pauling glasses.
Oh, yeah, I got them in my pocket.
Praise the Lord.
But my dad comes out of the water and says, "Where you guys going? Where you guys going from here?" And the pastor, Paul, he said, "We're going in revival." He said, "Well, can I go?" And I'm like a nervous wreck, man. I'm just, you know, like, "No, please, no, you don't know him, you know." But to make it short, what happened was my dad got saved.
Amen.
And, man, that day was another one of them happiest days of my life. He got saved. He accepted Jesus Christ as his personal Lord and Savior. And that just blew my mind.
Amen.
Because somebody really evil, somebody really mean that hurt people, you know, that you hear stories about. That was my dad they were probably talking about.
Did they start singing the song, "Pray for the Fish"?
I tell you, he would video them church services. And look here, you know, the guy holding the camera is always the loudest. You know what I mean? Everybody be singing. Guess who you heard when you watched the VCR tape? Now, this is before he got saved. He was videoing these church revivals. You'd hear him singing on the camera. "Brother Willie, you grunting like that sounds like we're smoking weed. I'm going to be accused again." He's over here took a puff off a cigarette and grunting. And I thought, now that sounds like somebody smoking weed, man. Oh, God.
I don't think so.
Oh, Lord. But anyway, it was awesome. My dad got saved.
Amen.
And now here we're getting lied on saying, and he did used to, you know, do that.
Amen.
Now, my dad, he does take medicine. My dad had open heart surgery.
Yeah.
They've done the last surgery. They had to take 4 veins out of his legs stuff, and they told him they can't do no more. And, you know, so he does, as far as I know, now I've never seen him, you know, but as far as I know, that's how he does take marijuana for the medicine.
Right.
Now, I don't know as far as, and he told me and you on the phone that he did not do that in Rhine, Mississippi, as far as smoking weed or as far as passing me a joint. I know that didn't take place. You know, I know for a fact because I've never, you know, I did smoke it years ago, tried it, didn't like it, you know.
I did too, and all it did is made me hungry.
It gave me a headache. I mean, it really did. But I did make a mistake when I said I hadn't drunk a beer in about 5 years because when Chuck passed away,
I
did take three drinks, one for the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost with Chuck in the car on the way back from Nashville.
That's right. I called you up that next morning.
Sure
I told
did.
You, and I says, there's a little error there need to correct.
Well, I took 3 drinks, but I said I didn't drink a beer, a whole beer, you know.
Right.
So anyway, but thank you, because that's what you're supposed to do.
That's
you called me up, and you said, hey, you know, you said, so I like that you called me. You didn't get on the radio. Yeah, you're a drunk. you know. I saw you drink a beer.
It's just like what we were talking about earlier, that there's a way to do it in the scriptures. It says go to the person one-on-one.
Yeah, that's right. Now, that's getting dressed. That's being dressed.
And then if he don't go do that away, you bring a brother.
Amen.
And if that don't work, you bring the church.
Amen.
And if that don't, what's the next thing you do? You dust your feet.
Amen.
Off,
if
and
they
you put
don't,
them in the hand of an unjust God.
Amen. If they're not listening by the third time, brother, I mean, they ain't going to listen to us. It will definitely take God to shake their world.
But here's the problem with the flesh, okay?
Yeah.
The problem with the flesh.
There's all kinds.
They get angry. They just want to skip.
Yeah.
All three and just go
straight to dusting. Go to hell, brother. Go to hell.
That's right.
I mean, it you know, the biggest thing is right now, as we get down to these end times.
That's right.
I mean, you got to understand, the Lord tells us to love one another as he loved us. Now, let me tell you how good he loved you, that he's forgave every sin you ever done.
That's right.
Now, let me tell you how good some of these false prophets love you. They don't forgive nothing. They'll condemn you to hell in a minute. But I got news for you. I got news for you. Don't even worry about it, because if they're out of the will of God, they have no power of God in their life.
That's right.
And if a man uses that power of God to threaten people and tell you, well, I can if I want to. That's not God. I can't. If you don't do this right now, I can condemn you to hell. That ain't God. God says forgive your brother how many times?
Seven times 70.
I mean, how many times? Forgive them.
That's 490 times a day.
I mean, if they sin. Now, here's the problem. Like me, I was accused of doing something I didn't do. Like
right.
Job, you know, everybody trying to get Job to repent. Job's like, I didn't do nothing, you know. I ain't done nothing.
That's right.
I didn't do it. But listen to my words. Listen to my words. If I've done anything to you, any enemy listening, if I've done anything to offend you in any way, I'm sorry. I'm not sorry for preaching the gospel. I'm not sorry for standing up for the truth. But if I am blocking you from obeying God, I don't want to be a stumbling block, man.
That's right.
You see, separate yourself from me. Get away. If I'm blocking you from serving God, get away from me and go serve God.
That's right.
And I'm going to go serve God. And listen, the disciples come across a situation where somebody was casting out demons.
Oh, yeah.
You know, and they forbid him. And they run and told Jesus what they done. He said, look here, if they're not against us,
they're for us.
Leave
That's
them alone.
Right.
Leave them alone. I'm not against you if you're trying to preach the gospel.
It's just like different tactics. You go out and you preach to people in parking lots. I do it on the radio, and I go out
Amen.
On the streets and do it. See, we got to understand that as long as you're doing it for the Lord, you don't want to go out there and capsize somebody for it. That's right.
That's right. We got all these different ministers in this world that's right. obeying God.
Right.
See, I've told them many times, listen, there is people of God in every denomination you can think about.
Right.
And the denomination is false. But God's got people in there that's preaching and teaching the truth and trying to love the hell out of the world.
Right.
And that's the truth. And they do it different. We've all got Paul was different than John.
That's
John
right.
was different than Matthew. And we all come from different places of the world, but we got to go into the world. And we all speak parables with different nationalities and different languages. But it's still the truth, but I can't repent for something I didn't do.
Right. And why should you repent if something you didn't do? To make somebody happy? Now the question is, do you make man happy or do you make God happy?
I'll tell you this way. Yeah. I'll tell you how I feel right now in my heart.
Mm-hmm.
If I felt it was blocking anybody from hell, I've apologized to people for I didn't do what they said I'd done, but I told them I was sorry. And it fixed it. They just went on. My mother was mad at me for 3 years, threatened mm-hmm. my own mother, threatened yeah. to shoot me. And I went and I apologized. I didn't know what I'd done. Didn't do nothing
right.
except be good to my mother at that time in her life. But she got jealous because my dad come to visit and backed over her flowers. And I said, listen to what I said. I said, Mom, don't get upset. We'll buy a little fence and put around the flowers and they can see them. Because me and her shared the same driveway at that time of her life. And I said, they won't back over them. She got mad and thought I said, put a fence up between the property. Like I didn't want her coming out there when I had company or something. And that ain't what I said. And she got mad, man, and moved and threatened to shoot me, stuck a gun to my face, and my family standing there, my youngins crying. And she said, I brought you in this world. I'll take you out of this world.
I've had that. My dad tell me that one time.
I looked at my mom and I said, Mom, I love you. Do whatever you feel you need to, but I love you. You've misunderstood what I said.
But that's how the devil works.
Amen. But I did go and apologize to her. I did. And
amen.
It fixed it. And guess what? It was like a year, 13 months later, my mother come down with cancer, and I went to Kentucky and got her, moved her to Tennessee, put her in a home, took care of her. I was good to my mother. I love my mother. And my wife supported me and everything I've done for my mother and for my stepdad, Parnell Bentley. I took care of them until death. The thing is, when we're out here, like Paul right here, we're talking about, he had a made-up mind he was going to Jerusalem. Right. I got a made-up mind that I'm going to preach the gospel of Jesus, my precious Lord and Savior, until I leave this world.
That's right.
And it don't matter what nobody says or does against me. Now, these false allegations are going to come. They're going to come.
That's right.
Now, it does hurt when it comes from a friend that you consider to be a friend or an elder that you look up to. It does hurt. It hurts your heart. It breaks in two. And the flesh does rear up and you get angry. But God told me this, church, listen, my last battle, God told me, he said, do you want more of me? And I said, yes, Lord, I want all that you have to give me. He
Praise
said, then
God.
You love your enemies. You pray for them and turn them over to me, for vengeance is mine, saith the Lord. He said, you leave them in my hands and you pray earnestly for them that they get things right with me.
Right,
now, that means God, not me. He was talking to me. He said that they get things right with me. And I said, yes, Lord, they belong unto you. And I earnestly do that. I do
Amen.
That. I did it this morning. I've done it the other night. I'll do it every day. When I wake up, as Brother Willie said, did I get dressed? Yes, every morning of my life. When I wake up, I have to take my prayer time and I have to pray and ask God,
Amen.
Where do you want me to go this morning? What do you want me to do? Lord, I'm a willing vessel. Use me that thy will be done here on earth as it is in heaven.
Right.
Hide me behind that cross. Blot me out with the blood of thy only begotten
yeah,
Son.
Yeah, that's something right there. A lot of people, they talk about Jesus and they talk about God, but what are we both to do? We both to stand behind that cross every day.
Amen.
And let God use us in a mighty way.
Amen.
And
Amen.
If we sit there and deny, well, God, I can't do that right now because I ain't got the right clothes, or I ain't got the gas money to go, or I ain't. Now, how is that helping God? It's not helping God. It's just being what you call a slothful servant.
Yeah, amen. The slothful, listen to me, you sorry slothful things. Yeah. They get mad at me, but it's still the truth.
Amen.
It's still the truth. It's still the truth.
When the world's
amen.
On fire.
It's still the truth. We got many out there that are that way. But now think about it, because you know, as you're talking about the shoes, the preparation of the gospel of peace. Well, God was giving me that peace for my enemies. Not just one. I've got multiple. I got a guy keeps showing up at my studio.
Like what I was telling you last night in the revival. So I got more enemies than I do body parts.
I like that. That was pretty good. I got a guy showing up there in Crosville gonna threatening to whoop me because his brother is living in a homosexual lifestyle.
Now, why would he defend his brother's sin? That makes no sense.
Well, now, a lot of people do defend their family, though.
He's not defending his family.
I believe you told me that
lifestyle.
A while ago. I believe you told me. I said, look, I've got to. I'm going to be without some equipment, and you were sharing. You was telling me to take one of these soundboards and have it fixed and try to use it.
Right.
And I said, well, I'd rather just buy it off of you, or if you give it to me, you can't have it back. I said, if you get mad at me, you can't have it back. I'm so tired of giving back what people sent.
Amen.
They give it to God, and then when they're mad at you, they want everything back.
Yeah.
And Willie said, now the only reason I get mad at you if you attack my family.
That's right.
That's what he told me. So, see, this brother feels I'm attacking his family because his family's living in this lifestyle of homosexuality.
Right. Yeah.
And that's his brother, and he loves his brother. And he said,
yeah, but I'm not going to defend my family's sin.
Oh, now, there you go. Now, wait a minute.
Different.
See, now there, but, now, see,
now,
that's
what
it's hard to
see. You try to come physically harm my family.
Yeah, amen. You're going to rear up, ain't you?
Yeah.
Amen. You're the head of your family.
That's right.
And Christ is the head of you.
Right.
Amen. You better believe. If
now,
I'm...
see, that's the difference between, now, brothers and sisters, I want to make this perfectly clear. I like what we were talking about, soundboards and stuff here, that you can do anything you want to.
Yeah.
But if you physically try to harm my family in any fashion or form, you're going to see the other side of Willie you don't want to see.
Yeah. Well, you know where God's going to take you. Same place I went. You're going to love the hell right out of your enemy.
That's right.
Listen, that man, one of my enemies come on and was really hammering my wife. And it was all I could do.
Now that
to
that,
not
that
get
was
in
uncalled
self.
For.
It was all I could do to not get in self. But God showed me. God said, really earnestly pray, and I did. And then I had another guy come on and tell me, well, you don't love your wife. I would have went down there and, you know, blah, blah, blah. And I said, let me tell you something. I love my wife so much that I will give my life, and I did. Mm-hmm. I have every day of this battle. Mm-hmm. I've given my life for my wife because I pray that God let me not get in self.
That's right.
I believe God's big enough to take care of my wife. Mm-hmm. I believe he's big enough to take care of my son, Chris Chaney. I believe he's big enough to take care of my little grandchildren
that's
up here singing for God. I don't have to. Listen, God told me this just the other night again. He's told it to me many times. But he said, I never called you to defend the word of God. He said, I called you to preach the word.
Amen.
And unto death. Now, friends, listen. When you're being attacked and they're attacking your wife, your children, your grandchildren, that's your world, man. And it's hard, but if you'll do it, if you'll really hold on to Jesus.
That's right.
Hold on to Jesus. Preach the gospel unto death. God will take care of your family, and you'll be blessed in this life and the life to come. Do you hear me?
Yeah.
You will walk with the anointing and the authority and the power of God. He will open up the windows of heaven and pour out blessings on you and your family that
that's
you
right.
don't have enough room to receive. Do you hear me? It'll overflow into the streets. But don't get caught up when your enemy's trying to point their finger and hollering at you. If you point and holler back, you're no better than they are.
That's right. You can't render evil.
No, that's right. Don't do it. That's when you say, I got to pray right now. I got to pray. And
that's
get
right.
on the telephone and call your other friends and family. Say, pray for me. I'm being attacked. Pray for me. I don't want to get in flesh. Come on. Pray for me.
That's
the
right.
Bible says we must put the flesh under subjective. We got to pray every day to keep this flesh down.
Now, everybody, let me tell you something. Brother Eddie come up, and he went to prayer for his enemy last
night.
Amen. And I believe with all my heart and spirit that this matter is going to come.
I do. Amen. I believe God took care of it.
Because we all, up there under that tent last night, we all claimed it. It's going to be done.
It's going to be done. Amen. It's done. It's settled in my book. I've left it in the hands of God. I'm not only the one. I was being anointed. I've got two, like I said, coming in Crossville. They need God because now they're going to try to lay physical hands on me. And I've been that. They've hurt. You know, the first time somebody hit me, I thought I backslid. I said, Lord God, that ain't supposed to happen. What happened here? I thought because
I laid the hands on an anointed one. Yeah.
But I thought, you know, Lord God, what did I do? They wasn't supposed to be able to, you know, hurt me. And then God told me to go read. And as I read, I said, well, here they done crucified Peter opposite. And here, everything I was reading about men of God, they was always in trouble. They was in jail. They was on the run.
Brother Eddie, there's only one that didn't get crucified. Or die in some fashion or form for the gospel. Think about that.
Yeah, I know. We talking Old Testament or New Testament?
New Testament.
Yeah.
Revelations. All of them got prosecuted except for one, but he got sent to an island.
That's what I was going to say. That's prosecution. They thought he's a nut, and they locked him away on an island. They got him away from society, you know.
But ain't that like us sometimes, that they kind of pushes
Amen.
To the side and don't want to hear nothing. They
Amen.
Just say, well, we'll let the ducks be out in the duck field. I mean, we'll just
know,
keep them from a distance.
You know something that really touches my heart, like Paul here. You know, I hope and pray, listeners, today that you have a made-up mind that you're going to serve God.
Amen.
But, you know, it really touches my heart when I see people take whatever they got, the simplest of things, whatever it may be, an old broke guitar. And they don't, you know, like me, I don't even know how to tune a guitar. And I'll take an old guitar and I'll just get up and sing
for
God.
Thank the Lord for apps.
But I'll get up. Well, I don't know how to work the apps. But anyway, I'll get up and I'll obey God.
What are you going
to
tell on your age?
I know it. I will get up and sing because I'm not ashamed because I love God. Now, if you don't like what I do.
Yeah, talking about singer, it was a blessing to them grandkids here last night, wasn't it?
Man, I thought I was in heaven. I mean, I don't know how to describe it.
Go home and coming on home.
Yeah, I don't know how to describe it. It's so good.
I don't know. I ain't got a son or a daughter preaching right now, but how is it to see your son up or behind there and bringing the word? After all these years, you've been preaching and teaching,
man,
that you get to see one of your sons up there.
I've been called the devil, a liar, a wife, a beater. I've never touched my wife. I can stand before you this day and tell you this, God be my witness. It's been a blessing. My wife's never hit me.
Amen.
36 years of marriage, I've never hit her. But now, God knows that her family in Kentucky thought that I'd hit her many times. I was known in that part of the region. I was known as a wife beater. Lied on again. Amen. And that's the truth. I've been called a womanizer. I've been told I was pimping women under the tent. I've had women. I've had women call me. Their husbands call me and say, cuss me out and say, well, you had an affair with my wife, you know, 20 years ago. And then these people call me and they say, well, I just told him that we was in a fight and I had to make him jealous. And then they apologize. And then next week they tell me, oh, you done ungodly things to me. Listen to me. Here's the truth. Here is the truth.
Yep.
You take this to the bank just like smoking weed. I have never committed adultery on my wife. I've never let, now I've been offered. I've had women try. Hey, I took a load of household to deliver it one time and put it under the porch, and I went to the door. Man, and I thank God I was fully dressed that day because that woman wouldn't. When I went to get my payday, and she just dropped that robe, and she said, come on in, I'll pay you. And I said, honey, that don't pay my light bill. I said, I'm happily married. She said, well, I am too. That ain't got nothing to do with this. And I said, yes, it does. I said, you know, she had two or three kids, little kids running around. I'll never forget it. I said, well, just, she said, I got $20, all I got. I said, you know, we're talking $300 load of house coat back then.
Right.
I said, just give me your $20 and I'm going to load it all up and leave you $20. I started at that door and she had two or three little babies, like 2, 3, and 5 running around. They was little in diapers, two of them was. And I walked outside and I said, no, they can have it. And I left that little coat because of them babies. You know, but and I went straight home and told my wife what happened because I know, you know, rumors fly through a community and I didn't know who was.
Yeah, you
know,
always hear her saying this, you know, is a big old world. Let me tell you, word of mouth, travel
it goes,
quick.
Hey, it'll go faster than you can drive there, man.
That's right.
But anyway, the truth is when you're dressed with the armor of God and the devil and especially holding up that shield of faith, I've held it up for 36 years.
Amen.
I've got wonderful children. I've got a son out of the will of God right now.
That's
Benjamin
right.
Cheney. He's called to, he is a called evangelist. He's out of the will of God. If he died without repenting, without getting right with God and doing his first works over, let me tell you something, he split hell wide open.
Amen.
And that breaks my heart.
Yeah, it breaks my heart. The man is so talented.
Yeah.
God. I was sitting there one day, I was up there the weekend at your house, and he was playing that bass, and boy, he can make that thing roll.
And I also, I got family that ain't family, but are family.
Right.
You got to understand, my daughter-in-laws and my family situation, when we was in Kentucky and my kids met them, we were hooked at a reach-out center we done.
That's right.
And they come to that center every day, and we shared the gospel, and we give away food and clothes. We never sold nothing. In my lifetime, I've never sold nothing pertaining to the gospel. We give away our CDs. We give away anything pertaining to the gospel. I don't want to sell it because God gives it to me freely, and I'm not peddling the gospel. I'm preaching the truth, and it's free.
The biggest problem with people today, they want to put a price tag and try to get rich off of God.
Well, yeah, you know, I wrote a revelation. If you'll give me $5.99, I'll send you this book. That's a lie from the pits of hell, you know. But anyway, people like their ears tickled. People like all that commotion right now where I'm attacked on Facebook and I'm accused. They like that. They, you know, they feed off each other. See which one can stir up the most trouble.
Or just like you was talking about, you're going to get off Facebook and I said, oh, wait a minute. Whoa,
hey,
whoa,
I didn't have to get off. They hacked my page.
But anyways, you were talking about one time getting off Facebook and I said, oh, wait a minute.
Yeah.
Now, God's called you to preach. You both do it every access you
everything
get.
We can.
And I said, now, brother, you better pray real hard about that.
So it's your fault they're attacking me on Facebook.
I guess.
Well, I mean, no, it's the devil's
fault. You might
fault.
As well get a dose of it, too, because I'm getting it, too.
Yeah, you don't want to be alone, do you? Amen. But the truth is, the truth will be made known on all matters. Whether I'm here or not doesn't matter. Here's what matters. If you're out there and you're fully dressed, and you're going to be attacked. When you get up, if you're singing for the glory of God, if you're testifying, you're an overcomer. But guess what? When you leave that safety zone of all them brothers and sisters and that anointing under those old tents or in that church revival, in that place of worship, that building you're in, and you leave each other and you go out into the world, you're supposed to go to preach the gospel. You go to your own homes and you get ready to do whatever God's telling you to do, you're going to be attacked.
Amen.
You're going to be lied on, made fun of, run over, talked about. They're going to gossip on you. Raise your hands up and count it joy. See, if you know the truth and you're not guilty. Now, here's something I will make known. And I wish it would have been a beer, because I had a problem with beer years ago, and I used to drink.
Right.
And I repented. And if it was that, you know, I'd say, yeah. But I, here's me. If I had a smoked a joint, but I didn't. But if I had them, what would it matter to you? I won't care if you called me or not. Then I'd repent, and I'm right with God, so now deal with it. But I didn't. Now, this is why it's so hard. How do I repent for something I didn't do to help a man that's blinded right now? One of my enemies, blinded, and he believes he saw me now. He didn't say he thought he saw me. He said he caught me. Now, he didn't catch me. That means he's either blinded to the point of he can't even see. You know, I don't know. How do you tell people, here's what God told me. God said, there's no way that it's going to take God. I can't prove I didn't do that. He can't prove I did do it. It's my word against his word, and both words should be true.
Right.
Now, here's how you'll know. If you are involved in the ministry, Project Reach Out, and man, everybody's pulled back. I mean, it costs a lot of money.
Yeah.
But that's all right. But if you're involved in the ministry, here's how, if you're so close to God, only you that's judging me, go pray. God will tell you the truth.
That's right.
He will. He'll make it known. He'll make it come available. And when you realize the truth, then you pray for the one that is at fault, because listen, that's who we don't. That's who we need to help. You understand?
Yeah, amen. But here's something that rule is key. I've always had: pay attention to the details, what they're saying, and how they're saying it. Because you know, there are a lot of, the heart, as it says in the scriptures, the heart will speak with the lips.
Yeah.
Yeah. Now think about that. Yeah. Now, Brother Eddie,
whatever's in a man's gonna come out.
That's right. It ain't what you put in your mouth.
It's what comes out.
That's right.
Amen.
You know, it's just like we was talking about alcohol. I used to have a bad problem.
Now, that was my problem.
It wasn't beer. I was on the hard stuff. I was on liquor. That whiskey moonshine and all that. See, I'm an old Kentucky boy. And I used to make excuses. Well, I use moonshine for cold. Well, okay,
yeah.
I got a cold in 103 degree weather. Yeah,
you had a cold every day, didn't you?
Yeah, back in the day. But see, when the Lord changed me, that left. But you know, a lot of people today that wants to continue on, and say, well, it's a cough medicine or it's a herb,
whatever the excuse is. Let me tell you this. Here, we'll probably lose more listeners, but we'll gain three for everyone at least. Because here's the truth. Here's what I believe. See, I'm not ashamed to tell you what I believe. Now, now this is what I believe. This is in my heart as of this day. Mm. I believe this. I don't believe taking a drink of beer will send you to hell.
No.
I don't believe smoking a joint without getting high would send you to hell. I don't believe that. I don't believe that taking Tylenol will send you to hell. I don't believe that if the doctor wrote you Oxycontin pain pill and you took it, I don't believe it'd send you to hell. But now, if you abuse it, if you glut it, if you're taking it for entertainment purposes, if you take it to get high, guess what?
That's
sin. Because now you are not born again, you're not saved, you're deceived, and you are addicted.
That's
you
right.
are an addict.
Or
an alcoholic.
You're talking about drugs? What about sugar? Yeah. I mean,
some people addicted to sugar. My wife's addicted to Pepsi.
Right. And you're addicted to Mountain Dew?
I drink 7-8 a day, that's too much.
And your trophy tobacco?
Oh, don't get off my backer. God sent me my backer. Get off my backer. No, you're right. I love my chew tobacco. Yeah. I smoke an old pipe every
and
now and then.
I smoke a cigarette.
I like pipe tobacco.
Oh, yeah.
Every now and again. I don't smoke it every day, but I do. And I've had people tell me you're going to hell because you chew tobacco. Here's your kicker. I preached revival one time, the first night. Everybody getting saved, man, just a powerful move of God. They like 150 people. We seen people laid out in the spirit. We seen blinded eyes healed. We seen crippled bones put back. The next night, the same people come, and they brought people with them. You know, that in the day, that's how revival was. Boy, when God moved, you go get people that's sick and in wheelchairs,
amen,
and you bring them to the anointing of God, you know, wherever it may be.
Yeah.
And so the second night, here I am preaching and everything. Now, the first night, nothing changed. I preach with a chew tobacco in my jaw all the service. I don't have to spit. I can chew. I go to bed with it sometimes. I don't have to spit. And so here I...
That'd be something to wake up and your wife alone give you a big kiss and you forget.
Yeah. Yeah. Hey, the second night we preached revival, God moved. After service, I took the backer out. Well, this pastor standing there saw me. Now, it was his revival, and I was preaching in it.
Amen.
Check this out. He said, you can't get behind the pulpit no more. And I threw the backer down, and I said, why? He said, you can't get behind my pulpit. He said, you're polluting the body that don't belong to you. Don't you know that you're bought and paid for with a price? Your body don't belong to you. And he began to share scripture. And I just sat there and looked at him until he got done. And I said, good, I don't need to be behind your pulpit. I'll just keep on obeying God. I said, I don't need to be. Listen,
amen.
Listen, it ain't what goes in, it's what comes out defileth the man. See, what was in him now? What was in him? See,
yeah.
He loved me the first night. I just didn't get rid of my backer that night. I still had it in my mouth.
His man's tradition.
Now he was either
him up.
Yeah, it tells me he wasn't right with God.
That's right.
And he's going by tradition.
He had faith in scripture, not in the faith of the
that's
king.
That's right. Call me brother one night. Nothing changed.
Call you
and
the
then
devil,
devil
next.
The next night.
That's
because
right.
I did something he didn't like. I did something that he had a rule against. I did something that he thought was sin.
Right.
Not the word, he. And that's what's happened every time Amen. Your enemy comes against you. It's something they think you done. You know, not here's the sin. You know, here's the sin. You know, it ain't that. And then, you know, and then they'll usually fall back. Well, you got mad at me first. You know, and I'm like,
yeah.
That brothers, ain't the point.
Brothers and sisters, you know, when you first get saved, you're drinking milk, right?
Yeah, amen.
But after a while, you've been in church, and you're getting the scripture, and you're praising God. You know, sometimes you just got to get off of milk and get in the meat of the matter.
Get on the meat, amen. That's what we're talking about here is Paul's experience. You know, he was in the meat. He had enough confidence. He know the gospel. He know the truth that the Lord will protect me even if I die.
Yeah.
I'm going to go be with my precious Lord and Savior. You know, so throughout this lesson, we're going to learn, I hope, why our spiritual shoes matter and why we need to make sure we're equipped with them before we, you know, get into the battle.
Amen.
See, if you leave something off and you go to battle, well, guess what? That's a weak spot. That's the very spot the devil's going to
get like
you at.
That's like last week you was talking about the old boy that changed his clothes.
Yeah.
He hid himself.
Yeah, trying to hide himself.
What happened
the king.
When he hid himself? He got hit.
He got hit by a stranger.
Yeah.
Shot that bow and it went between the lashes, you know, latches there.
Yeah, the latches.
Yeah, and went in there and got him and killed him. But so it's important when we're getting dressed in the morning that we do pray for one another, that we do pray for our enemies. We pray for those lost in our community and around the world. We pray that God open our eyes and our ears that we may see and hear what thus saith the Lord. We pray that God dress us. See, when God dresses you, honey, they ain't no latches. Listen, he welds it on you. Do you hear me? I'm talking about there's no weak spot if you allow God to dress you. There's no, God's got you back. You've got the armor of God on.
Amen.
There's no way if you'll testify, if you'll share how good God is, if you'll share and obey the word of God, there's no weak zone that day. That day. Now,
that's
let's
right.
don't talk about tomorrow yet because there's enough evil sufficient for
tomorrow,
today.
Tomorrow, we might not even be here.
That's right. But for this day, I guarantee you the enemy can't touch me
because
I got dressed. He can't touch me. God's got my back. I got the full suit of the armor of God on me. I love the Lord unto death. Now, you tell me, how can the devil touch me this day? He can't do it. Not this day. If I hold on to that plow and I don't look back, I keep my eyes focused on Jesus, and I just simply... Well, it's called dying.
Amen.
Every day of your life, pick up your cross and follow after Jesus.
Amen. But, you know, brothers and sisters, today, we put our suit on, but we got to remind our families, too. Because if he can't get to us, he's going to go through our families and friends.
Yeah.
That's why every day that we get up, we need to be preaching the gospel to our family.
That's right. By doing it.
Be doing. And I mean, it's like I say, it's like Brother Eddie said, his wife being attacked from this.
Yeah,
enemy.
That broke my heart, man.
And, but, see, but what Eddie did, he came to his wife and says, pray through this.
Yeah.
Suit up, because it's going to be a battle.
Yeah, it's going to be a battle. We're at war.
Yeah, I mean, every day is a war, because if you think you're everything's great and everything's working just fine, you better... realize that something is wrong. Something's going to slip up.
Yeah.
When it does, it's going to fall hard.
Ooh, yeah, you got that right. Amen. So now we're beginning to realize. Just imagine it this way. Imagine a fully armed soldier, you know, out there. Imagine in your imagination. He has his sword, his shield, his helmet, his breastplate, his belt, but his feet are completely bare. Now just imagine that for a minute. I mean, this picture probably seems strange, but think about it. It should just be thinking about it. We can tell something is missing. Mm-hmm. Now, imagine right now these army soldiers we have over there fighting a war, if they were barefooted, wouldn't be a sufficient job being done, would it?
Right.
There's a weak spot, an open area of the armor. But,
another thing you got to understand, too, if you can't keep your traction, you ain't got your feet.
You slip back, ain't you?
Yeah.
The problem goes beyond just looking odd. Right. You know, a shoeless soldier couldn't run into the heart of the battle unless he's,
You ever try to
fight on AstroTurf?
You ever try to run across rocks?
Ooh, yeah, I can't go barefooted. I'll just tell you, I'm a wimp. I can't even go barefooted in my house, man. I go, ooh, I can't stand going barefooted. My wife run, play ball barefooted and everything, and I'm like, get some shoes on. Hurt my feet. I can't even stand it.
Praise God.
I'm a wimp, man. I can't help it. But we do want to encourage you today. If you're not dressed, you got to realize you can get wounded. If there's if there's something you left off of the armor of God, if there's something you're not applying in your life,
amen.
You're going to be wounded in this war. And this war is real. And there's souls hanging in the balance. There's souls hanging in the balance. You know, I want to talk just a minute, if I can. What is this gospel of peace we're talking about? You know, are there different gospels in the Bible concerning the peace? I want you to grab Matthew chapter 4, Brother Willie, there. Go to Matthew chapter 4, and I'm going to have him read verse 23. Matthew chapter 4, verse 23. And I know some of you know it by heart, but let's let Brother Willie share it with us.
All righty, Matthew's 4, verse 23. And Jesus went into all of Galilee and teach all the synagogues and preach the gospel of the kingdom, and heal all manner of sicknesses and all manner of diseases among the people.
Now, something I want you to catch when you get dressed with God. Now, notice here that he went into what? All the
synagogues.
Those are your churches.
That's right.
Do you understand? I don't know how many people tell me. They say, now, Brother Eddie, you're awful hard on these pastors. you're awful hard on, you say you go to these churches and if they lock them, that you'll kick the door down. I will if God sends me there. I will, because he has sent me to these synagogues, today's church buildings, they call buildings of worship that they're not given to God. They claim they're the house of God, but they're not. You and I are the house of God. We're the body of Christ. We're the church. And he does tell us to go into these synagogues. So now we're talking about getting dressed. And here's what happens. Now here's what gets me. Now look what happened. Now Jesus lives in you and I if we're born again.
He said,
these things I've done, greater things you shall do.
Right.
Now, okay, what did we just see Jesus do? He healed all kinds of sicknesses and all kinds of diseases. Well, how come when you go to your place of worship, you go with, now this is going to make you mad and hell is hot.
Yeah.
You go with cancer and you leave with cancer.
That's right.
You go with a cold and you leave with a cold. Or it not be that way.
You go in with a limp and come out with a limp.
Or it not be that way. Not what I read. Listen. Two or three gather up. Two or three gather up. Jesus is in the midst. If two or three gather up, if two touching any one thing, you know the problem? People don't agree. You got these so-called apostles running around thinking you got to ask them to obey God. Listen to me. Listen to me. He said two or three gathered up.
Amen.
Who's in the midst? Jesus.
Jesus.
Anything two laying hands on, agree upon. He said it shall be done. Do you understand? He said, now these things I do, you should do even greater. Now we see getting dressed. Now we see in the gospel being preached right here. And Jesus went about all of Galilee.
That's right.
Teaching in their synagogues and preaching the gospel.
That's right.
Of the kingdom. Do you understand? And healing all kinds. Now, pick up Mark. Go to Mark, those of you. This is interesting. Man, I love the word of God.
Mark.
It's my bread. Mark. The Lord is my bread when I'm hungry. He's my water when I'm thirsty.
All right, Mark what?
Yeah, Mark chapter 1, look at verse 1.
All right. Hold on. I'm going to go on. My fingers are a little big today. All right. Mark 1. All right. The beginning of the Gospels of Jesus Christ, the Son of God.
Why do you think that's there? Nobody catches this, hardly at all. The beginning
of the Gospels of Jesus Christ, the Son of God.
Read verse 2.
And as it is written, the prophets, being, behold, I send my messenger before thou face, which thou shalt prepare the way for thee.
Huh. There's a beginning to the gospel.
That's right.
There's a beginning. We know that God is the beginning, the I am, but we're talking about this good news we're sharing. We're talking about the power of God.
That's right.
There's a beginning taking place right here, and they're sharing it with you. Here comes the beginning. This is the beginning of the gospel.
That's right.
This is the beginning of the gospel, not the end, the beginning.
It's like that third verse there. And the voice, one that cries out in the wilderness, prepares the way, and the Lord makes the path straight. That's what we're doing.
Well, the beginning of the gospel.
Ain't that powerful? Yeah.
You can go on down and like verse 14, talking about now after John was put in prison. Wait a minute. You mean a man of God went to prison?
Oh, yeah.
I bet he got talked about. I wonder if he was smoking wild herbs.
probably down there.
Now after John was put in prison, Jesus came to Galilee preaching the gospel of the kingdom of God.
That's right.
Preaching the kingdom of God.
But you notice what it says there. He's preaching the kingdom of God. He didn't say he was preaching an album or he was preaching any fellowship. He was preaching the kingdom of God.
Hey, look at Acts chapter 20. Amen. My cord's starting to short out. Praise God. All right. Acts chapter 20, verse 20. I'm just sharing these because they're on my heart. I love the word of God, but write these down. Get time. Read them. Allow God to write his word upon tablet of your heart, my friend, and then apply the word of God to your life and watch what God does for you in your life. I'm telling you, we don't got to walk around sick and afflicted. We don't got to walk around with our heads drooped down like we've lost our puppy dog. Amen. And the most miserable looking people I run into are these religious people. They are miserable. Amen. And that's the truth. They're miserable.
You know, it seems like lately that we both be a joyful people. But it seems like there's a lot of frown faces when they go, especially when they go to church. You ever notice that, a lot of that? A lot of people that wants to, they say they love the Lord.
Yeah.
But they go in there.
Poof. Look like you had a funeral.
Yeah, like somebody kicked their dog or something.
Yeah, I know. Right here is going to help them. Listen, we're supposed to live each day of our life as though it's our last.
That's right.
So this could be the end of my race today. This could be my last day on God's given earth and the time he's allotted me. I don't know. It could be. Yeah. Watch this. Look at Acts 20, verse 24. See, but none of these other things. I'm going to let Brother Willie read it for us. Acts 20, verse 24.
All right. Acts 20, 24 is a... But none of these things that move me, neither count I of my life dear unto myself, so that I may finish this course with joy.
All right, hold it a minute. If I believe today's my last day, I want to finish it with joy.
That's right.
Come on, finish reading it.
And the ministry that which I have received, the Lord Jesus Christ, to testify the gospel of the grace of God.
Here's what I hear out of 99.9 of these religious people claiming to be saved, claiming they got God. I don't know what I'm going to do today. My lumbago's got me. I've got to go to the doctor and get my nerve medicine. They give me, I got to get something done. You don't hear joy. You don't hear happiness. You don't hear this could be our last day and you're going to waste it complaining and murmuring about how the flesh feels. The
Amen.
Flesh is going back to dust. You better be getting suited. Because you're at war, whether you like it or not, believe
Amen.
It or not, friends, you better be getting dressed with God. I'm talking about a joy that's undescribable here. I'm talking about today could be the end for me. Do you hear me?
That's
Woo! Glory, hallelujah.
Hey,
brother,
hey.
I tell you, you're on your own. If I go to be with the Lord, I don't even know if I'm going to pray for you up there. I'm too busy worshiping the Lord.
Amen.
I'm going to be shouting all over the kingdom of God. Do you
Praise
hear me?
God.
My God, it's a joy unspeakable.
Amen.
Do you not grasp the word of God? Do you not love it? I love the word. I love the anointing of God. I love my precious Lord and Savior.
Amen.
He's my all in all. He's my everything, friend. We want to encourage you if you're listening today and you're not, and you do not know Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, we want to encourage you right there where you're at. Get things settled. Get things right between you and God. Reach out. Take a hold of that unchanging hand of the great I Am, my friend. Listen, drug-infested, alcohol-filled, he'll take you. If you'll go to him with a broken heart and a contrite spirit, he will in no wise cast you out, friend. Sell out to Jesus.
Amen.
Sell out to Jesus. Get dressed. Amen.
Amen. I'm going to take a little time right here to invite anybody that's in going to be listening tonight. We still got the revival going.
Amen.
Up there on top of the hill at Landmark Apartments. If you need a healing, or you need to be delivered from somebody, or you just need somebody to listen to you,
come on.
Don't put it off. Don't say, well, that. They can't help me. We can't, but we know a man that can.
Yeah, come on.
Amen. So, brothers and sisters, we all invite everybody. I don't give care if you're a drug dealer, a womanizer. It doesn't matter. Won't you get changed, like in the twinkle of an eye, by our Lord Jesus Christ?
Come on.
And if you can't do it that right there and then, just continue to stay on that altar to get what God's got for you.
Yeah. Amen. Come and get dressed and put on these shoes we're talking about.
Amen.
The preparation of the gospel of peace. Because today, the way of peace, there in Romans, I believe it is, chapter 3, he's talking about they have not known. But then you see in spirit of all human attempts at peace, it's clear from the daily news, you know, that we watch now, that this world does not know the road to peace. It's clear. Yeah, Romans chapter 3, verse 17, I believe. Were they 17 or 18?
Right, 17.
Yeah, 17. Yeah.
All right. And the way to peace, let's see. And the way of peace we have none known.
Yeah. See, and look at your news today. Look at your news. Look at what's going on. It's evident. It's plain to see. And it's plain to see that if you get up, and you say, and you're born again, and the devil's afflicting you with some kind of disease, some kind of sickness, some kind of spirit trying to get upon you. Well, listen to me. You get in that place between you and God, and you claim and stand upon the word of God. You will be healed this day.
That's right.
This day. I'm talking about right now. You can be set free. You can be delivered from any addiction. You can be set free. Healed, cured, right.
Amen.
Now. From cancer's nothing to God. But here's the thing. Now, you can't hold on to the world with one hand and God with the other hand.
Yeah.
You can't put your trust in doctors and man and say you got your trust in God.
Yeah.
Now, unto death, Paul had a made-up mind. Paul knowed if I go over there, they're saying they're going to kill me.
That's right.
But he said, I'm a going. I'm putting my trust in God. And if I leave today, if I die today, it's a joyful time, but I'm putting my trust in God.
Amen.
I told my boss I got hurt at work a while back, and I wasn't in my right mind. You know, I was had a concussion.
You never been happy in your right mind.
Oh, God, I opened that, didn't I? Anyway, they took me to the doctor. I told them, don't never do that again. I don't care how bad I'm hurt. You pray for me. You set me off to the side. If I live, we'll thank God. If I die, we'll thank God. But don't take me to the emergency room. Call Jesus. 911, get Jesus on the main line. Now, if I live, we'll thank God. If I die, we're going to thank God. See, because that's my whole purpose in life, is
Amen.
To put my trust in God. Now, listen, I've been hurt. I got an arm hurt right now I'm praying for. It's already been delivered. It's
Amen.
Already being healed. And I ain't going to the doctor. It may rot off tomorrow, but I'm holding my faith in God. Now, listen, this is personal. Somebody today's got cancer. Somebody today's looking at their last ray of hope. Somebody today is being faced with something you're only hearing about or thinking about. Somebody today's been told a negative report. Somebody's went to the doctor. The doctor's telling them, you don't have long to live. Let me tell you, you're not going to leave this world until God says it's time.
Amen.
And then you get worried and worry about what that doctor said. Get in the word of God and look at the promises of God.
Amen.
Honey, let me tell you, if I die today, cancer didn't take me. They said I had a brain aneurysm years ago, was supposed to die, and I didn't die. I'm still going.
Same
if
here.
I die today, no brain aneurysm killed me. It's because God took me.
Amen.
You understand? You can't leave one day early, you ain't leaving one day late.
Amen.
Because we ain't in control of that.
I thought there was something about me and you having. I had a brain aneurysm one time.
I did too. They said.
Sure did. They told me that they give me 3 months to live.
That's what they'd give me, 3 months.
3 months, and he said,
"That's odd."
And I first thing I was in the denial. I'm going to die and all that. And then all of a sudden, the Lord told me, and he says, "Didn't I put you on this earth?" And then that, here's the funny thing. What he told me, he said, "Take your shoe off."
Ooh.
That's all right. I took my shoe off. Look on the bottom of your foot. Well, I looked on the bottom of my foot. Where's your expire date?
That was good. Couldn't find one, could you?
Couldn't find one.
Wow.
He said, "You're not done yet, so put your suit on and go on."
All right, I wanna share with you while you're talking about that suit. Mm-hmm. This piece I'm talking about, to find, when you follow Christ, and I'm talking about follow Christ's steps in the way of this real peace I'm talking about. It's how I've learned to pray for my enemy, as Christ said upon the cross, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." We must realize that our war is with the devil and the legions of angels. It is not a fleshly war.
No.
We cannot seek vengeance on people that is trying to hurt us or our families. We cannot take evil for evil.
Amen.
That doesn't work.
Vengeance is I, say the Lord.
To follow Christ's steps in the way of real peace. Now, some say, well, how does that, how do these spiritual, shoes help us stand, firm? Go to John. Yeah, book of John, chapter 14. And I want you to see what Jesus left with you. This is how you're going to know. Remember, you're supposed to know the tree by the fruit it bears.
John 14, what?
14, verse 27.
And John 27, it says, "Peace I leave with you, my peace I give unto you. Not as the world gives, but give unto you. But let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid."
Wow. Now, we're talking about our precious Lord and Savior says, "Peace I leave with you."
That's right.
"My peace I give to you."
Right.
Wow. You want what God wants to give you, friends? Right here. He says, this is our precious Lord and Savior saying, "My peace."
But I like that very last part.
Amen. Come on.
Where it says, "Let not your heart be troubled."
Don't let it be troubled.
Neither let be afraid.
Don't be afraid.
Now, trouble and afraid is two different things.
That's
but
right.
He says it's covered.
It's covered.
Yeah, he says, be not troubled or afraid.
Here's trouble. When the doctor told me I had aneurysm,
right,
and I was going to die, go home, get things in order, and I began to worry and fret. I had every emotion there was.
Amen.
I got mad at God. I got upset with my wife. Why I'm young. I don't want to be a burden. Why am I going to die at a young age? Why is this happening to me? Every emotion. And then I went from this troubled stage to this place of being afraid.
Amen.
And I said, now, whoa, have I got everything right here? Wait a minute. Am I going to heaven or hell? And then I went from there. This peace, he says, this is what I love. Go back to the first. And he says, "Peace I leave with you.
Amen.
My peace I give unto you." And I thought, you know what? I'm going to believe the report of the Lord.
That's right.
I'm healed. Jesus, give me the peace. I'm healed. And I stood up that day, poured that medicine out. Now, everybody, don't do this. You better pray. Get it worked out between you and God. I had 27 different kinds of medicine. I poured it outside, and I said, that day, I'll hold on to the unchanging hand of God. And I didn't. Man, I don't even, right now, I don't even like taking a Tylenol for a headache. There's times I do, and I pray over the Tylenol.
Amen.
So don't, devil, don't you twist my words and tell people, listen, God will work through a doctor. God will work through medicine that's took right.
God will work through all kinds of things. Now, let's tell
you,
Lord says give thanks to everything.
Anything you put
in your mouth,
that's
your
right.
hand,
you're supposed
you give
That's
thanks.
Right, and it can't hurt us.
That's right.
That's right. We're praying sanctification. We're praying that word of God. We're standing on
promises
anything,
of God. Yeah, anything. It's just like your car. If you get a car or get a truck or you get a house, first thing, you give thanks.
Yeah, amen. Thank God.
Then you ask the Lord to anoint it. And then, if it is medicine, make sure that God's in the matter before you do anything.
Amen. Here's part of getting dressed. That's if right. you go to the doctor, ask your doctor, does he know Jesus Christ
right.
as his personal Lord and Savior? Because if he don't, you ought not be letting him work on you.
Because the devil goes through
many
packs.
Amen. The devil's trying to kill us. And yeah. No, I'm not getting in an airplane unless I ask the pilot, does he know Jesus? You know, I mean, that's a fact. Yeah. And I do this today in my life. If I would have been awake, I would have asked them at Crossville, but I didn't know where I was. But that's you better right. believe I asked them in Nashville. When I woke up at Vanderbilt, that doctor was standing over me, and they was trying to twist my foot. I said, whoa, do you know Jesus Christ? He said, yeah. And I said, good, I got a revival. I got to get out of here and get my britches. I said, we got revival in Cookeville, praise Tennessee, God. And I invited him to come. And he said if he was off work, he would, but he didn't get to. But my first word was, do you know, well, not really the first, probably like maybe the seventh or eighth. As the conversation started, then I said, hey, wait a minute.
Probably the first word, whoa, what am I doing here?
I don't know if that was my first. my first was I had revival. I know I woke up with, I was supposed to be in revival, which it was the next day. So yeah. But I thought it was that day. I didn't know what day of the week it was. But yeah. Anyway, God took care of me. He'll take care of all of us. But know this. If I believe God will work through a willing vessel. Amen. That could be a doctor. It could be a truck driver. It can be a bus school driver. But I want to know. I want to hear them. If they're going to operate on me, they're going to tell me now.
Amen.
I don't want the lost operating on me because, listen, you're either saved or you're lost. You're either right or wrong. You're on your way to heaven or hell. Now, you either sold out to God or you sold out to the devil. And the devil's trying to kill the children of God. Do you Amen. Not understand? He is after you. If you are born again, bathed in the blood, you've got to realize we're at war and their souls hanging in the balance.
That's right.
So get dressed. That's what we're talking about right here on Bible Study 101.
Amen.
Amen. I am your host, Evangelist Brother Eddie Chaney. We got Brother Willie with us today. We're going to take a little bit of a break. We're just going to raise our hands up, listen to some music, worship the Lord, and we'll be back in about 10 minutes or so and
Amen.
Finish out the study. And but we love you. Thank you. Give a big shout to Bonnie there in the chat room.
Hey, Bonnie.
I believe
God
we
bless
had,
you, girl.
Ann and him was in there. And yeah. those that listen to the archive,
Amen.
We love you too. Thank you for stopping by and checking out Bible Study 101 right here on the Gospel Music.
And again,
inbox.
Before we go to the music, we're going to get the prayer lines.
Yeah.
We got plenty of people around here in Scottsville, Crossville, Cookeville that wants to pray for you today.
Yes, Lord.
So, brothers and sisters, my number down here in the house of prayer will be 1-270-681-8098. Now, if you want to talk to Brother Eddie Chaney's prayer line, it is 1-931-229-0768.
Amen.
You can call them 24 hours, 7 days a week. You get about 3 minutes. But you can call them many times as you want.
Yes.
So continue to be praying for others
yes.
as we pray for you.
Yes, Lord.
Amen. Amen. God bless.
We'll be back just in a few minutes. Enjoy the music. Try to raise your hands up and just worship the Lord. Because he's good, church. He's good. Let's see if it's going to play.
Well.
I don't hear no music with Jesus on that main line.
Wow.
No music. I guess it sounds like I'm going outside. Praise God. I can't hear it in my headset. I don't know if we're going over the board right now. I don't think we are. I don't think we're going. I think it's, yeah, we are. Praise
that's,
God.
That's you.
All right. Yeah, but no music. But anyway, I'll just sing to you. Well, Jesus on that main line.
You gotta love it.
But I can't hear me in my headset. I don't hear me. Oh, now I hear me. Ooh, that sound bad. I don't like hearing me. Anyway, Jesus on that main line. Tell him what you
All right, let's try something here. For
he
sake.
Don't want me to sing. I'm going to sing.
Let's see. Right, praise
Ain't
Lord.
God good?
God good. God is good, church. Listen, if you don't know Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, please.
You and God, that's what's going to matter when you leave this world. Where will you spend eternity? That's the bottom line. Where will you spend eternity, heaven or hell? I pray you accept Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, friends.
I don't know what the situation is, but I can't get the money. I can't get to the place.
he said he don't know. Get a bigger hammer out here. I don't know what to do. I got
tools in there, but I'm a guest.
I don't know. I wish I could take a picture. He got.
We just had music. Let's see, that's how the devil works. We just had music. Now it's gone.
Well, you made the devil mad. See, that's all that is.
Well, that's my priority job.
Thank God for that. Amen. Let's just make him mad enough where he'll leave. Get on down the road. Because we ain't got time for him. Amen. Hey, if you're listening today, and I heard something change that time. If you're listening today and you got an ache in your heart, I want you to know Jesus will take that ache. All you got to do is cast your cares upon him. It's cutting in and out, I do believe. I can hear my mic cutting in and out. Amen. But it shows to be going through, doesn't it? But it's not.
Anyway,
here's what I suggest. All right. Let Jesus hear your heart, your achy, breaky heart. He's the only man who understands. And he will heal your heart, your achy, breaky heart. He's the only man I know who can. They nailed him to the tree. He died for you and me, so we wouldn't have to live in sin. Now sickness and disease he took for you and me, if we would just put our trust in him. Let Jesus heal your heart, your achy, breaky heart. He's the only man who understands. And he will heal your heart, your achy, breaky heart. He's the only man I know who can. They laid him in the grave. For 3 days he laid, with a promise that he would rise again. On that third and final day, the stone was rolled away, and he rose triumph over sin. So fall down on your knees and ask the Lord, please, to help you find a better way. Now you will be just fine. Leave Satan far behind. Tell him you are walking out on him. Let Jesus heal your heart, your achy, breaky heart. He's the only man who understands. And he will heal your heart, your achy, breaky heart. He's the only man I know who can. Yeah. All right, Brother Willie.
Amen. So here we go. We're going to play a little music from my cell phone. We're going to see how it picks up. Praise the Lord. So
praise the Lord.
Inside the gate, where loved ones await. wear a white robe.
I'll wear a white robe in the glory land.
people gone wrong, and the
Amen. Boy, the Lord's good. Amen. Hey, I want to do a little announcement here. Any of you that's listening right now, if you'd like to call in and participate on the program, you can call Brother Willie's prayer line right now, and he'll try to answer it. And we'd love to hear from you.
Amen.
Amen. And, you know, we want to give you that opportunity while we're talking. If you that's feel right. led, you'd like to call in and be heard, share a Bible verse with us. Brother, since the sound ain't working on your computer, you want to give them your cell phone number, and you could do what you just done. If they call right now, live, right here on the radio program.
I can't remember my number, so I have to look it up.
All right. While he's looking it up, those of you, we're going to finish out the study. Go to the book of Luke, chapter 10, and I want you to really pay close attention to verse 19 and 20. But, I mean, read the whole thing when you got time as you're studying and allowing God to write his word upon the tablet of your heart, knowing that once you're dressed with the full armor of God, you know, look in Ephesians chapter 6, start about verse 10, and just allow God to write his word upon the tablet of your heart. But right now, I'm getting ready to share with you a thought out of Luke chapter 10. Verse 19 and 20, because he's talking about, behold, I give you the authority to, you know, me, I say trample on, but I mean, you know, I'm just paraphrasing here now. I'm not reading the verse itself. We'll get Brother Willie to read that to us just in a minute. I'm just sharing with you a thought on the verse right now. But read it and look what he says, because, you know, I mean, man, you're talking about trampling on scorpions and over all the power of the enemy. And nothing shall by any means hurt you. You know, but we don't rejoice in that. No, we rejoice because their names are written in heaven. This is the part I was telling you. If you're being attacked by so-called men or women of God, and they're threatening powers of God that they can do to you if you don't do certain things, listen.
Sounds a whole lot like witchcraft, don't it?
Yeah, that's a dangerous place for them to go.
Amen.
The only time that they could do anything is through and by the anointing of God. Right. And if they're not in the will of God, they're out of the anointing of God. You know, but know you, if you're dressed this morning, if you prayed, if you're walking with God, you're born again. Look at Luke. Also, I mean, just his shoes allow us to walk on, you know, otherwise, I say, painful terrain.
Amen.
You know, without fear. When you got shoes on, you don't care to just hut right across that old hot black top.
Amen.
Try it barefooted. You know, but talking about these shoes.
You got to make a key element there. You got to believe.
Yeah, yeah.
You got to believe that God will protect you.
Yeah, I'm putting my shoes on.
That's right.
Yeah.
But if you go out there and you have any doubt.
Yeah, that's
what's
not going to
happen.
Yeah, that's
not fall.
Yeah, ooh, that burned. Yeah, that ain't right. But just as
the
these shoes.
Why I say that, remember what was it Paul when he would try to walk? Peter would try to walk across the
on
water.
The water, yeah, and he took his eyes off the Lord.
What happened? He nearly drowned.
Yeah,
a little faith.
Yeah, ooh. Just as these shoes, you know, they protect us from the rough terrains.
Amen.
So does the preparation of the gospel of peace. It allows us to travel, to go in places otherwise painful trails.
Amen.
And tribulations of life without fear. You got to understand, knowing that what awaits us is greater than anything we could possibly suffer in this world. Look
That's
at
right.
Romans chapter 8, verse 18. I'll get Brother Willie to read that to us. We're getting ready to close out this part of the study. Amen. Study number 4, we're talking about the shoes. Have you put on your shoes?
Romans 8,
You know, Romans 8, verse 18. 18. Yeah.
Oh,
okay.
Yeah. For I reckon that the suffering of the present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us.
Wow. Ain't that powerful? Ain't that powerful? Amen. I mean, just the word of God. Here it is, plain and simple. You know, it don't matter what we're going through.
Amen.
You know, but we got a hope and a promise waiting, ain't we?
Amen.
Praise God. I'm excited today.
Everybody, if you got it right in the sound of our voices tonight, if you got any prayers, this is my personal cell phone number. You can call anytime. If I'm working, just leave a voicemail and I'll call you back. My number will be 1-270-943-8429. You can call anytime. And as a minister of the Lord, our job is to help you in this troubling time and hour. Because, you know, there's troubles everywhere. But we're asking you to call in if you got a prayer, a testimony, or just want to say howdy. Come on. But let's take this very time and moment and hour right now. That if you're seeking God, let me, Brother Eddie, and whoever else is in the prayer room, chat room, to pray for you and your salvation. That we can't pray you into heaven. That has to come from you.
Yeah, amen. It's called working out your own, ain't it?
That's
amen.
Right. My personal law.
Praise God. All right, it is personal. Begin relationship with Jesus Christ. I mean, I thank God for the prayer warriors, but the truth is, listen, if you're sold out to the Lord, if you're born again, you're going to find a lot of times you think you're walking alone, but you're not. Christ is going to lead you. Now, your brothers may let you down. Your friends may let you down. Your family may let you down. But God said, listen, he'll never leave you.
Right.
He'll go further with you than anybody you know on this earth. God will remain with you, my friend. Hold your head up high because you're somebody. You're a son or a daughter of the Most High.
Amen.
You are precious. You are important. If you're listening today and the spirit of depression is trying to jump upon you, rebuke that in the name of our precious Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. If the sickness of cancer or any kind of bone marrow disease is trying to attack you, rebuke it in the name of Jesus and walk upright before God. Get dressed. Get dressed. If you get dressed, if you'll die daily, pick up your cross and follow your Jesus. He's got work for you. Listen, it ain't by accident you happened upon this little radio program, my friend. It's by heavenly divine appointment that you're right here, right now, right where you're at. Now choose you this day. Whom will you serve?
Amen.
We want to give you opportunity to call in live before we go on the air. If you'd like to comment or just shout howdy, we'd love to hear from you. Brother Willie's got his cell phone up and ready and waiting.
Yep.
If God's give you a Bible verse, maybe you want to call in and preach. We want to encourage you to obey the Lord. What we want to do.
Like you're saying, brothers and sisters, this floor is for the Lord. And if something's burning on your heart and you got to get it out, just call it. You know the number's there.
Amen.
An opportunity. It's just like I tell everybody that comes around me. If you're a minister of the Lord and you want to preach the gospel, my door is always open.
Amen. Praise God.
I don't think Eddie's got a lock on his door.
No, I
don't. If you live down there in Crawfordville, Tennessee.
Come on. Yeah.
He'll give you directions. You can't find it, can't get a hold of him, call me.
219 Red Fox Drive, Crawfordville, Tennessee.
There
they call it, the place I live is called Wind Ridge Estates.
Yep.
Come on out. Amen. And we're going to love you so many ways you have to like one of them.
And now here mine is 207 South Wilkes, Scottsville, Kentucky. This ministry is right behind my house. If I'm not working, I don't ever leave this door locked anyway. But if you want to come here, I got an altar. If they look right behind him,
yeah,
I got an altar.
There's an altar right here.
I got a cross here that you can, if that's what you got to do, if you got to have something to focus on, it's a cross.
Lots of people need. I love these old fashioned altars.
Yeah, and I always wear a cross around my neck.
Yeah.
But the main cross, understand, is the one you carry spiritually.
Yeah, amen. In
as
your
you
heart.
Walk through this
in
life.
Your heart, amen.
So,
God's good.
So, brothers and sisters, if...
He's saying if you want to come by and pray, come on.
Yeah, yeah, don't let the devil take another day from you.
That's right. Amen. Stand up with the authority that God has given his children.
That's right.
If you're born again, stand up. Begin to feel this joy we're talking about. This joy that's unspeakable, man. This could be your last day on this earth.
Amen.
Now, I'm going to spend it. What are you going to do for the kingdom of God today?
You going to be in the land of doubt or in the land of the
Lord? Like that place. I like right here, right now, man, and knowing the joy of the Lord that is overwhelming. It's better felt than it is told. Please, if you don't know Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, come on, get dressed. Go to him with a broken heart and a contrite spirit. Grab a hold of that unchanging hand. And if you live, I guarantee you when you raise up, within a very short period of time, it may be a day, it may be 3 days, I don't know, it may be 5 minutes on the altar,
amen,
you're going to be saying, somebody, where's the water hole?
Amen.
I want to be baptized, and I encourage you to be water baptized. It's a fulfilling of the scriptures, the
That's
word of
right.
God. But now know this, if you find yourself down on your knees right now, right there where you're at, getting things settled between you and God, and you repent, you go to him with a broken heart and a contrite spirit, and no wise cast you out, he'll take you. If you meet death, what time you're getting things settled with God or immediately after,
amen,
just like that thief, Jesus said, today, you shall be with me in paradise.
Amen.
And, you know, so that's awesome. We've got a hope. We've got the word. Now, reach out. Won't you, friend, take a hold of the unchanging hand of Jesus Christ?
I'd like to send a prayer for my father-in-law, W.D. Payne, in
yes,
this very
Lord.
Moment, Brother Eddie. If you don't mind, would you listen to prayer for him?
Yes, Lord.
He's having cancer, and the doctor's up.
Yes, Lord.
So well, I ask you to send a prayer for W.D. Payne.
Right, do that right now. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, as we come to you for W.D. Payne, Lord, I want to speak to this cancer that is in W.D. Payne right now. I want to speak to this cancerous cell in the name of Jesus Christ. I command that you flee this vessel. I command through the authority and the word of God that W.D. Payne be made whole. Be made whole. Be made whole as he spends his last days in this joy that we're talking about that's unspeakable, Lord. Your joy, Lord, paint him right now with your anointing that he feels your presence even as we're praying, standing by faith on your promises and your word, Lord. We are healed. W.D. Payne is healed in the name of Jesus Christ as we stand upon the word of God, as we stand as intercessors for W.D. Payne, as Brother Willie has brought this to us, Lord, and we bring it to you. In agreement with Brother Willie, as we stand on your word, Satan, we rebuke you in the name of Jesus. Take your hands off of God's property. In Jesus' name, flee cancer.
Amen.
Flee in Jesus'
yes,
name.
Lord.
Our precious Lord and Savior, the only begotten Son of God, we do pray.
Amen.
And amen. God's real. He's not dead. He's alive. He's the same today, yesterday, and forevermore. He's not changed. He's still healing. He's still saving. Praise God.
Amen.
Woo, glory. Hallelujah. I'm telling you, church, grab a hold of that unchanging hand. I can't wait to hear the praise report on that.
Amen.
I'm looking forward to hearing.
I'm waiting.
Amen.
I'm waiting.
We're going to keep waiting and praying. And just, my God, it's a good day to be alive.
Amen.
It's a good day to die if you're born again,
amen,
if you're bathed in the blood. Either way, I'm a winner, whether I go or whether I stay, as long as I hold on to that unchanging hand of the great I Am, my precious Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Church, know that we love you. I'm going to give it over to Brother Willie. I'm done my part of this, but I want to leave you this scripture.
Amen.
Please write down Isaiah chapter 2, verses 2 and 4. You want to read that, and it's teaching you about this piece we're talking about. Look at Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6 and 7. It'll explain to you more what I'm trying to get across to you. As far as talking about the peace, because the Bible makes it clear that when God's kingdom is established and the entire world begins to live God's way faithfully, I'm talking about the resulting peace will be universal. I'm talking about in the kingdom of heaven, this new Jerusalem that's coming down, there will be no more war, no more fear, only the worldwide peace. Isaiah 9, verse 6 and 7. That's love them, and Isaiah 2, verses 2 and 4. It's just going to finish up the study for you. I pray that you do study. I don't share all of the studies with you because I want you to get in there and get your own. You know, I really do. I hope that you do write down the verses, and I hope that you go back and listen to the archives, and I hope that you get into the Word of God for yourself and allow God to write His Word upon the tablet of your heart. Brother Willie?
Isaiah 2:2. And it shall come to pass in the last days, the mountains of the Lord, the house shall be established in the top of the mountains, and they shall be exalted above the hills, and all the nation and shall flow on up unto it. For there are many people that shall go and come, and let us go into the mountains of the Lord, and the house of God of Jacob. And He will teach us His ways, and He will walk in His path. And in Zion will go forth in the law, and the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. And He shall judge among them the nations, and they'll rebuke many people, and they shall beat their swords onto the plowshare. And they shall spears will be plunged in hooks, and the nations shall not lift up their sword again against the nation, neither shall they learn the wars of any more.
Amen. See, we're talking about a peace that's just it's so awesome. Right. And this is coming if we hold on and endure to the end. If we hold on and endure to the end. If we don't let go of the plow, if we stay focused, we stay dead and allow Christ to reign right. In and through us. Church, sell out to God. That's what we're telling.
Isaiah 9:6. For unto us the children is born, unto our sons is given, and the government shall be upon His shoulders, and His name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Peace, the Prince of Peace. And of the increasing of the government and peace, that there shall be no end unto the throne of David, and unto the kingdom, and to the order, to establish and the judgment. And in the just for henceforth, forever, and that the seal of the Lord of the host shall be performed this.
Amen. Amen. We got a hope, brother. Today's a good day, church. Know that I love you. I would ask you to remember us in prayer. Remember Brother Sam Graham there in Crossville, Tennessee. Amen. And his wife, June Graham. Well, just remember all the co-workers I work with at Graham's Tea Service. Just remember me and my family, the Chaneys, that we be found doing what God would have us to do, going where God would have us to go, and saying what God would have us to say. Remember the revival night right here in Crossville, Tennessee. I'm getting ready to head back. I mean, in Southville, Kentucky. Amen. I'm getting ready to go back to Crossville here in a little while.
Folks, he's dazed and confused. He'll know where he's at.
Yeah, you got it right. Amen. I'm in the spirit, boy. Feeling good. God's good. Amen. Please remember the revival tonight. We was blessed to get a help witness to God in the housing project there last night. They came out, they fellowshiped, we talked, we invited, offered to pray with them, and they said, some of them said it was coming tonight. They confessed that he was backslid on God. They needed prayer. They had been in church, but they quit church. They've been hurt and wounded, and we just need to love the hell right out of them.
That's right.
And that's what we're going to do. So please pray for Chris Chaney, Brother Willie Grizzle, and Danny Scruggs, and Brother Joe Wallace, as they step out to simply obey God. And each one's doing what God told them to do through this revival. So it's an awesome, awesome move of God. We love you. Be sure to check out everything on the Gospel Music Jukebox. We got music, we got preaching, we got testimonies. Get involved. Pick up the phone, call, and leave your pre-recorded testimony, prayer request, and let the devil know with a punch right upside the head. Be an overcomer with the word of your testimony and the blood of the Lamb. God bless you till next time, church. We love you. Be good.